Hello, my dear enthusiastic learners. This is Ravishankar Mangala, former vice principal cum head of the Department of Statistics, Vignan Degree College, Guntur. In this lecture, we are going to learn about the introductory concepts of probability. So the content I was prepared in this lecture is based on one of the NPTEL courses titled with Data Analytics with Python, particularly the first lecture of second week. So first, let us have a look at the agenda of today's lecture. In this lecture, we are going to discuss about the basic terminology involved in the theory of probability, as well as the different approaches of probability. First, basic terminology. What are the terms we need to know in theory of probability before going to discuss about the different approaches of the probability? The terms are random experiment, sample space, event, mutually exclusive events or disjoint events, equally likely events, independent events, collectively exhaustive events. So first, random experiment. Simply, a random experiment is defined as an experiment or process for which the outcome cannot be predicted with certainty. For example, in the tossing of a coin experiment, we know all the possible outcomes of this particular experiment. When we toss a coin, we may get head on the upside of the coin, or we may get tail on the upside of the coin. So we know all the possibilities of that particular experiment, but we cannot predict which outcome comes up after tossing a coin. So that's why this is an experiment which outcome cannot be predicted with the certainty. There is no exact, no information exactly what we are going to get as an outcome. Similarly, another example for the random experiment is throwing a die. And one more example for the random experiment is drawing a card from a deck of cards. In all these experiments, we know all the possible outcomes of that particular experiment, but we do not predict which outcome comes out as a result. So that's why that process or an experiment is called random experiment. Now the second term is sample space. The set of all possible outcomes of a random experiment is known as sample space. It is usually denoted by S. So as we discussed earlier, in the first example of tossing a coin, all the possible outcomes are head and tail. The set of all these possible outcomes are known as the sample space and usually denoted by capital S. Similarly, for the experiment of throwing a die, our sample space will be set of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. All these numbers represents the number of dots come on the upper side of the die. Similarly, one more example. Suppose a class consists of boys and girls. I want to select 3 students from the class at random. So, this is selection 1. In selection 1, we may select at random either a boy or a girl. And in the selection 2, and this is selection 3. We need to select 3 students. So, all the possible outcomes, B stands for boys and G stands for girls. And for each of these outcomes, again, we may select either boy or a girl. Either boy or a girl. So, finally, the outcomes for this experiment are all the 3 members are boys, or all the 3 students, one boy, and girl, boy, girl, and boy, girl, and girl, boy, girl, 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 boy, and all the 3 are girls. So, there are totally 8 possible outcomes are there, and the set of all these 8 possible outcomes constitute a sample space. Next one, event. Event means an outcome or defined collection of outcomes of a random experiment is known as event. Events are usually represented with uppercase letters like A, B, E1, E2, etc. If, for example, for an experiment of throwing 2 dice, for example, experiment of throwing 2 dice, one event may be defined as the sum of the numbers on 2 dice, is 7. And we may define another event as the numbers on 2 dice are equal. For this experiment, we can get a total of 36 outcomes in the sample space as an ordered pairs of 1, 1, 1, 2, 1, 3, like that, and so on up to 6, 6. There are 36 possible outcomes are there for this experiment of throwing 2 dice. From this experiment, I defined 2 events. One is the sum of the numbers on 2 dice is 7, and the second one is the numbers on 2 dice are equal. These 2 events are nothing but the defined collection of outcomes. So, for the A, the outcomes are 1, 6, 2, 5, 3, 4, 4, 3, 5, 2, and 6-1. These outcomes came from the sample space based on the definition defined in the event. The sum of the numbers on two dice is 7. Similarly, the outcomes for the event B are nothing but 1-1, 2-2, 3-3, 4-4, 5-5, and 6-6, because the numbers on the two dice are equal. So like that, we may define one or more events from one experiment, and all the experiments, all the elements, all the events are nothing but the subsets of the sample space. So we may define an event as any subset of the sample space also. Next one, mutually exclusive events or disjoint events. These are the things that can't happen at the same time, or events with no common outcomes. So mutually exclusive events or disjoint events, two or more events are said to be mutually exclusive events or disjoint events when those two events cannot happen at the same time. For example, from the deck of cards, drawing the aces and drawing the kings, both cannot happen at the same time. So there are no common outcomes in these two sets, these two events. Getting aces is one event, getting kings is one event. So there are no common outcomes in these two events, so that these two events are said to be mutually exclusive events. If we define the two events as getting hearts and getting kings, if we define the two events like this, there is one common element. There is one common element, that is heart king, in common. So that's why these two events are not mutually exclusive events. Next one, equally likely events. Each event has exactly the same likelihood or exactly equal chance of happening, then those events are said to be equally likely events. So in the previous, as we discussed earlier, from the class of boys and girls, if we need to draw three students from the class, then the possible outcomes are boy, 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 girl, boy, girl, boy, boy, girl, 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 boy, boy, girl, boy, girl, girl, boy, girl, girl, boy, girl, girl, girl. So for all these eight elements, for all these eight elements, the chance of occurring each element is same, because among the boys and girls, the chance of selecting a boy is nothing but 1 by 2. The chance of selecting a girl is nothing but 1 by 2. So here, for this particular element, the chance of getting all the three boys is nothing but 1 by 2 into 1 by 2 into 1 by 2, which is equal to 1 by 8. At the same time, for all these, the remaining elements, the chance of getting all these elements is also 1 by 8. And each element is represents one event, that is called elementary event. So that all these events are nothing having equal chance of likelihood, or same likelihood or equal chance of happening. so that these events are said to be equally likely events. Next one is independent events. Events are said to be independent if the occurrence or non-occurrence of the events is not affected by the occurrence or non-occurrence of the previous events. For example, winning the lottery and running out of the milk. So winning the lottery on the road and running out of the milk in the house, no way concerned, these two are related. So such kind of events are said to be independent events. Similarly, taking a cab home and finding your favorite movie on cable, or getting a parking ticket and playing craps at the casino. All these events are said to be independent events. Similarly, collectively exhaustive events. Two or more events are said to be collectively exhaustive events if at least one of them must occur. For example, for an experiment of tossing a coin twice, the event of one event is defined as there must be at least one head and the second one is there must be two tails only. That means the outcomes for the event A are nothing but HH, HT, TH, and the outcome for B are nothing but TT. So these two events are said to be collectively exhaustive events when A union B should be equal to the sample space. At least one of them means A union B. So A union B is equal to the sample space, then A and B are said to be collectively exhaustive events. So here in this case, A union B is equal to our sample space for the experiment of tossing a coin twice. So hence A and B are said to be collectively exhaustive events. And now coming to the different approaches of probability. Till now we learnt about the different terms involved in the probability of, in the theory of probability. Now we are going to discuss about the different approaches of probability. There are three kinds of approaches are there to define the probability. One is classical approach or mathematical approach. Second one is empirical approach and statistical approach. And the third one is axiomatic approach. First one is classical approach or mathematical approach. If a random experiment consists in n mutually exclusive and equally likely outcomes in which m of them are favorable to the occurrence of an event E, then the probability of occurrence of event E is denoted by P of E and is defined as P of E is equal to favorable number of cases divided by exhaustive number of cases, which is equal to probability of E is equal to M by N, where M should be less than or equal to N, because the range of the probability, any probability value should be in between 0 and 1. The range of any probability value is in between 0 and 1. This is the fundamental, most basic, important property of the probability. So here the probability of an occurrence of an event E is nothing but favorable number of cases divided by exhaustive number of cases or total number of cases. See, if there are totally n number of cases, and among those n number of cases, m of them are favorable to the particular event E, then what about the remaining elements? What about the remaining elements of the total? The remaining elements are nothing but n minus m. These are the number of cases for non-occurrence of the event E, which is denoted by E bar. E bar is nothing but the complementary event to E, which is the non-occurrence of the event E. So in that case, probability of the non-occurrence of event E is given by n minus m divided by n, which is equal to 1 minus m by n, and hence probability of E bar is equal to 1 minus probability of E. That implies probability of E plus probability of E bar is equal to 1. This is one more property of the probability. But the question is, when we have to apply this classical approach or mathematical approach? We have to apply this classical approach or mathematical approach when the random experiment consists of mutually exclusive and moreover equally likely outcomes only. When the random experiment does not consist the equally likely outcomes, then we may not apply this classical approach or mathematical approach. Second one is empirical approach or statistical approach. It refers to the probability based on the historical data, that means based on the experiments. If we repeat the same experiment again and again, then the probability of occurrence of the same event may change accordingly. So the formula for calculating probability in this approach is also the same formula, but where m is nothing but the number of times an event E occurred and n is the total number of trials, that means total number of times you performed the experiment. Usually this value will be large. Usually this value will be large in statistical approach. So the another name for empirical approach or statistical approach is experimental approach. So in this approach, the probability is based on the experiments. So you should perform the experiments manually, repeatedly, and you have to get the odds from that experiment. And the last approach is the axiomatic approach. It gives us the set of rules which are applicable to all types of probabilities. The first rule is, axiom one is, for any event E, probability of E is always greater than or equal to zero. This axiom is called axiom of non-negativity. And second axiom is probability of the S is nothing but the sample space. So probability of the sample space is always equal to 1. That means axiom of certainty. Axiom 3 is, for any two disjoint events or mutually exclusive events A and B, probability of A union B can be written as probability of A plus probability of B, which is called the axiom of additivity. So these are the rules, a set of rules applicable to all types of probabilities. Wherever you calculate the probability, you have to check all these rules. So, in summary, in this lecture, we learnt about the basic terminology, that is various terms involved in the theory of the probability, and also the different approaches of the probability. And once again, this content is with reference to one of the NPTEL lectures titled with Data Analytics with Python, particularly the first lecture of second week. So thank you. Thank you, one and all.